The Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services Center for Clinical Standards and Quality brings you CMS QI Voices. As part of this series, CMS is hosting several special episodes to provide nursing homes with the facts needed to discuss care plans with residents and families in order to improve resident outcomes related to the COVID-19 virus. In conversations with the CMS Chief Medical Officer, nursing home leaders will hear about the latest information on COVID-19 vaccines and therapeutics from CDC and FDA experts. Let's listen in.
Welcome. I'm Dr. Lee Fleischer, Chief Medical Officer and Director of the Center for Clinical Standards and Quality at the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. The purpose of this audio series is to provide our nation's nursing homes with clear, actionable messaging about the most impactful interventions to increase vaccination rates and reduce mortality from COVID-19 in nursing homes. Today, I'm joined by one of my colleagues who is from the Food and Drug Administration, Dr. Peter Marks, Director of the Center for Biologics Evaluation and Research, or CBER. Dr. Marks and the center which he oversees is responsible for assuring the safety and effectiveness of biological projects, including vaccines. Dr. Marks, welcome. Thank you for joining me.
Thanks very much for having me.
Can you share with our audience what makes the latest version of the updated COVID-19 vaccine different?
So let me just back up and say that SARS coronavirus 2, the virus that causes COVID-19, first came on the scene in the United States in early 2000. And the virus has evolved significantly and is now quite different looking to the immune system from what it originally looked like. That means that if one either had COVID-19 or was vaccinated against the original virus, one now has diminished protection against the virus. So the latest version of these COVID-19 vaccines, the updated COVID-19 vaccines, contain two components in order to better protect against the currently circulating versions of SARS coronavirus 2. One of these components is against the original strain of the virus, and that provides a base of protection against a variety of the viral variants. The second component is an updated one that better matches the currently circulating coronavirus strains, which happen to be derived from the Omicron lineage. And by receiving one of the updated vaccines, one has the immune system then trained to recognize the virus as it has evolved over time. And that can be quite important for an older individual who may have been vaccinated well over a year ago, and receiving one of the updated boosters could make the difference for an individual between having either no illness or only a mild illness from COVID-19 and ending up severely ill and in the hospital or even worse.
Thanks so much for that explanation. We're focused on the nursing home and long-term population in this recording. And I'm wondering if you might share some of the positive outcomes we know individuals who receive this updated vaccine have, and you talked a little bit about that, compared to those who only got the primary or the primary with a previous booster.
So thanks for that great question, because over the past several weeks, we've started to get in data obtained using the updated COVID-19 vaccines. So first of all, the safety of these vaccines is very similar to the previous vaccines. And particularly in older individuals, that means there's a very good safety profile here without any significant safety signals of concern. Regarding effectiveness, the updated vaccines appear not only to restore protection against severe outcomes like hospitalization and death, they also appear to reduce symptomatic disease in the population over 65 years of age by 50 to 75%. And although that doesn't sound perfect, perhaps, it's actually quite an achievement given the type of virus that SARS coronavirus 2 is, because it is quite an immune evasive virus that essentially is able to hide from the body's ability to generate an immune response. So for comparison, this type of reduction in symptomatic disease, as well as serious illness, is every bit as good or better than the protection we generally see from influenza vaccine on a good year. So the top line message here should be that anyone who has not received one of the updated vaccines, particularly anyone over the age of 65 who has not received one of these, should consider getting one at this time, particularly given the current wave in which there's been a real increase in cases of hospitalization and death. And what applies to those over 65 also applies to those with other diseases that put them at risk of more severe COVID-19.
Thanks. And you talked about the safety a bit, but you know, in this population, the over 65, the people who may be residing in a nursing home, what are some of the side effects that someone who is in the nursing home or long-term facility may experience after they receive this updated COVID-19 vaccine?
So the most common side effects that the adult population experience, which tend to be actually less so in the older population, are a feeling tired, usually for 1 to 2 days after the vaccine. Occasionally, people may feel kind of muscle aches or even joint aches, and less commonly, there could be fever. So essentially, in totality, it's a little bit feeling flu-like and fatigued for a day or two, but those generally go away within that time, and one is then left with the better protection that's provided by these vaccines.
Thanks. I'm not over 65, but I did experience those symptoms, and you're right, they went away quite quickly. You know, you and I over the last couple of years in our federal roles have really been dealing with misinformation around the COVID-19 vaccine. What are some common questions you've received about the updated vaccine or the previous? You know, what is accurate and more importantly, what is not, so that we can continue to inform both the residents, but also their families as they're making these decisions?
Well, there's a lot of inaccurate information going around about the COVID-19 vaccines. It's kind of hard to understand why that's the case, because vaccines licensed by the FDA have been proven over the past centuries to have saved millions upon millions of lives. So vaccines that are authorized or licensed by FDA must pass very high standards for quality, safety, and effectiveness. So now, perhaps the most pernicious of the current misinformation is that the vaccines somehow cause more illness and death than COVID-19 does. And that is just blatantly untrue. COVID-19 has taken the lives of more than 1 million Americans. And when we search for deaths directly due to the vaccine, we're hard-pressed to even find possibly a few that are associated with receiving the vaccine. On the other hand, we know that recent reports from very reputable sources estimate that more than 3 million lives in the United States alone were likely saved by the COVID-19 vaccines. Other misinformation regarding the COVID-19 vaccines, usually associated with younger populations in terms of the circles in which it circulates, include worries about damage to the genetic material or problems with fertility or potency in men. And those assertions are just blatantly false as well. And there we know that because we've been doing extensive safety surveillance along with our colleagues at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in millions upon millions of people in the United States who've received that vaccines. And also our colleagues globally are doing the same. And in over 1 billion doses of the mRNA vaccines that have been given, there's no evidence whatsoever that the genetic material is altered or that fertility is altered. And so these are all things that really have been spread as misinformation for reasons I don't quite understand, but there's no evidence whatsoever to support it.
I want to emphasize that number, 1 billion doses. Certainly, we would be seeing lots of problems with that kind of dosage. So thank you so much to both you at the FDA and our colleagues at CDC for the unbelievable surveillance, both here and actually, as we know, worldwide. My last question is really about this unique time with sort of the threat of three different viruses, respiratory viruses, you know, between RSV and the flu and COVID. So do you have at this moment any recommendations for both the residents again and the family members with regard to why it's particularly important this season, this winter, to get one or both vaccines?
Well, thanks for that question. I have quite a number of older relatives in their 80s or older, and I treat them when I go to visit them very much as if they were, even if they're in their homes, I treat them as if I would if they were in a nursing facility. So I would, first of all, ask to make sure that their vaccine status against not only COVID-19 with the updated boosters, but also against influenza was up to date. We want to take all the precautions that we can to reduce the chance of these respiratory viruses that can be quite severe or life-threatening in the older adult population. I'd also want to potentially take some extra precautions at this time of year. One obviously has to balance the social interaction versus protection, but I would consider wearing a mask and at the very least, consider good hand washing when you go to visit loved ones in a nursing facility, as some can be carrying either COVID-19 or influenza without knowing it, and that helps prevent the spread. This is one of the ways that I think all working together, we can help reduce the chance that our older loved ones are adversely affected by the current somewhat trifecta of three respiratory viruses that are potentially affecting the older population, all circulating around the same time.
Couldn't agree more, Peter, and thank you so much. I will be practicing tomorrow as an anesthesiologist, and the entire time I'm in the hospital setting, I will be wearing a mask, not just in the operating room, to protect those that I could come in contact to, again, in a hospital setting, could be immunocompromised. So thank you so much for your time today and for the incredible leadership you are providing to our nation in order to advance safety and health in the age of the COVID-19 pandemic and beyond. To our listeners, thank you for joining. Be sure to join us next time to hear more impactful interventions for increasing vaccination rates and reducing mortality in nursing homes.
To learn more about today's episode and to access all of the CMSQI Voices audio series and show notes, please visit qioprogram.org/CMSQI Voices. Thank you for listening to CMSQI Voices.